Hi, everybody. One of the reasons that really drew me to Aspire when I was thinking about the CEO job was just how much we as an organization embraced so many different services. And one of the particular aspects of service that really enthralled me, partly I think because of my background in clinical work in addiction, was our work on recovery. And so I couldn't be more pleased today to be talking to my colleague and friend, Darrell, who I've come to know and enjoy as somebody who has enormous experience and such a contribution to give to our organization as a leader generally, but in the field of recovery as we really uncover more knowledge and understanding about subjects like recovery capital. So we're going to talk a little bit about that today with Darrell. But Darrell, it's great to be with you, and I'm really happy that we can have this conversation.
Thank you. It's good to be with you as well.
I wonder whether, so a lot of people will know Darrell, of course, but would you mind starting with a bit of your background, a few sentences about how you've come to this place?
Yeah, right? Sure. So I was in the for-private, world for years working for, privately held organizations and publicly traded organizations. And there came a point in my life where, my alcohol use became a problem. And I had an amazing experience with people that came to support me during that time. And it was such a transformational experience that I wanted to work in this space. Mm. So I began to volunteer in recovery houses and not tell people what my background was. I had had some executive positions in other organizations, and I just thought, I really just want to be able to be of service. And so I came to Progress House just over 9 years ago, and through a series of events, was given the opportunity to lead this organization. And then we saw that we needed a partner because people were coming to us sicker than I'd seen them when I first got here. And so the integrated model that we have here and these additional services have really been a game changer. So the consolidation of Aspire and Progress House 5 years ago is what has led us to you and I being at this table.
Great,
so,
and to be colleagues.
That's right.
And sharing story. And I'm very interested in the personal testimony that you bring. And I'm very conscious, although not as knowledgeable as you, about the importance of personal experience in the recovery community and how people in the journey of recovery look to others for guidance, support, advice, role models sometimes, accountability often.
Absolutely.
The story you tell is an example to others, I think, in some ways.
Right.
It's also a vision for others, perhaps, I guess. Would that be fair?
I think that's a great point, Antony. It's if somebody asked a word that I would use if I wasn't using recovery to describe this space and experience that we're discussing, I would say it was connection.
Yeah.
And it's very hard, when you reach critical times in your life through a series of either substance abuse, alcoholism, some potentially, bad choices that have caused harm to people that you love, that you reach this place where, you feel isolated and you don't have a lot of hope. Mm-hmm. So being able to meet somebody who, as they begin to describe their experience, they understand what it is that you're feeling right now, mm-hmm. and that your fear and your concern about, where your life is and where it may be headed is powerful.
Yeah.
And when I talked to somebody and I heard them describing some things, I had this thought, how do they know that about me?
Yeah.
Like they had read my mail.
Yeah.
And so that gave me hope.
Yeah.
And it was, as I said, it was so transformative that I thought this is really something that I'd like to do professionally.
That idea of passing things forward, passing the message, the approach forward and helping others, it feels very important. It feels like really critical to the recovery community. And there were some people in your life, and I hope it's okay to ask you about this, Darrell, because I know very recently you lost somebody who was important in your life. Who was that person for you?
Right.
Do you mind just speaking to that relationship and what that brought into your life and your recovery journey?
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'd be happy to. My sponsor of over 10 years, who actually, died a few weeks ago with 59 years of sobriety.
Wow.
You know, when I met him, you know, I had heard this phrase that you should go to 90 recovery meetings in 90 days, and I went to 120 of them because I'm an overachiever. But I wasn't willing to do the things that were suggested. I was going and trying to intellectually connect and just gather some knowledge. I thought I would just be shown how to drink a little more responsibly. Mm-hmm. He took me through this process of saying, you know, there's literature and some specific instructions that if you do those, the desire to drink and drug will be removed and your life will change from the inside out. And he talked about spiritual growth. And that experience with him of going through, it was really 164 pages of a book that's been around almost 90 years. Mm. And him doing those things with me and being willing to walk alongside of me and share his experience. It was almost like, you know, having a travel guide saying, okay, I'll show you where all the problems are that you could run into on this course, but I can't walk it for you. But I will walk alongside of you. That experience was, it was life-changing for me. Mm. And through that process, I got connected to him in a way that, a respect and a love developed. And what was interesting is all the years that I worked with Gary through example is how he showed me this way of life called recovery. Mm. And that's pretty powerful, when you're used to trying to out-hustle people and out-hustle things and to have somebody say, no, let me show you that this is a team sport and we'll be of service to one another. It's changed everything about my outlook on life and, you know, my family and my relationships. Yeah. So there's no way that I could ever repay him except but to, you know, what he said is you need to freely give away what's been given to you.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is about, you know, continuing to pay it forward.
Helping other people understand this way of life called recovery.
That's right.
Darrell, we're sitting in Progress House, an amazing facility because it's an amazing community. Give us just for the uninitiation, and many people will know, but give us three or four sentences about what goes on here.
Yeah, so Progress House is the oldest and largest recovery residence in the state, and men come here who have been abstinent from alcohol and drug use, generally from a treatment facility or incarceration, but they come into this environment, which is what we refer to as an abstinence-based environment.
Yeah.
And they receive what we refer to as our whole health recovery services, which include our medical services, our behavioral health services, our peer services, case management. We just saw some people getting dental services downstairs.
Yeah, amazing.
So they have this wraparound service delivery in an environment with another 85 men. So there's, you know, we have the ability to have 86 in this building. Who are in the same on the same journey and modeling for one another what it looks like to be able to navigate life with its challenges without the use of alcohol and drugs. So it's a tremendous community with all of these intense services in a safe environment for 6 months.
Yeah.
So I really think of this place as a place to practice.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you apply these things called recovery principles to your everyday life?
Yeah.
Because they're going to experience everyday life here.
That's great. That's great. And I absolutely must learn to say Progress House as opposed to Progress House, this rather plummy accent, I'm afraid. Sort of, I struggle with that. You know, we're learning still in the field of recovery, aren't we? And in some ways, we're trying to get ourselves on that platform where we are seen as, well, in some ways equivalent to all those medical treatments and so on. And there's been tensions, haven't there, between the treatment and the recovery platforms. And we're trying to overcome those tensions, those historic tensions. And I think we've done a good job of that here, Darrell. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. I think, you know, when people look at our model and, you know, the model here has gotten national recognition, for its innovation. You know, bringing these evidence-based services into a place and braiding funding streams together for clients is really nothing new under the sun. I think the thing that makes what we're doing here so unique is culturally.
Yeah.
We've been willing to sit down with our licenses and our degrees and our organic experience and our love for the clients we serve and talk in a way about whole health for that individual that is unique to healthcare organizations or behavioral health organizations. That's really the magic of what we're doing here.
And the outcome's pretty good, right?
Yeah, you know, traditionally we were considered a premier program for decades, and we were in the 35% to 40% success rate.
Yeah,
we now see 70% plus successful outcomes, defined by if a person begins the program, do they complete it? And it's 5 to 7 months to complete it.
Yeah.
So that's a huge number.
Yeah.
If somebody were to just go to rehabilitation or just treatment and then stop, the likelihood of long-term recovery is less than 10%.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's, you know, and this is the, before COVID, this is our number one public health and public safety issue.
Yeah.
So to have outcomes that, you know, exceed university outcomes, you know, people getting degrees that begin, you know, university. It's phenomenal.
So in my amateur brain, and I don't know as much as you, but that sticking with the program for as long as possible, hopefully till the program's conclusion, you know, the thoughts, models, ideas about this way of life called recovery, they have more stickability if you stick with the program, right? Is that the essential
thing? Yeah, I mean, science shows us that if somebody can get to that 6 month mark, it's not just you know, incremental improvement, it's like a exponential, it's like a hockey stick, the likelihood of continuing.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, we have to continue, but that's what we provide, you know, people here with.
Yeah.
You know, so the notion of recovery capital, right? The things that you and you know, the other leaders in the organization have asked me to focus on.
Yeah.
That's really about the resources or the currency of the things needed to sustain long-term recovery.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's things like we do here in services, but then there's also, you know, how do I as a client and, you know, move on from here, you know, and understand that I need, you know, these positive strength-based things.
Yeah.
You know, for I think traditionally we've measured things in this space sometimes with negative outcomes. We got a negative drug test.
Yeah.
We have, you know, less drug use. Instead of having strength-based, you know, markers and ways to measure somebody's likelihood of success.
Yeah.
And so it's changing the dialogue. It's a cultural piece, but it is bringing these concepts that are spiritual in nature, if you will, because they don't just treat your brain and your body, but they treat your well-being emotionally, your heart. But bringing those things, you know, to a place where science intersects.
Yeah.
And research intersects, and doing that in a way because we can actually put recovery principles on our policies.
Yeah, yeah.
In the way that we deliver services.
Well, let's touch on that as we sort of conclude this piece of conversation,
sure.
And we'll have many more conversations moving forward. But let's touch on the future and the what next. And I know we've got a group that is coming together to think about the components of our addiction treatment and recovery supports services. Mm-hmm. And you're a critical voice in that group, and we're thinking about recovery capital and we're thinking about expansion. But two or three things that are on the horizon for us, Darrell, do you mind speaking to that?
No, thank you. Not at all. I think that's to me, a reflection of the commitment of the organization.
Yeah.
To even go down this road and say, let's bring together some more, you know, people in the organization that can take a look at how we're delivering services, and ensure that we're incorporating, you know, both the best, you know, medical practices, the clinical practices, therapeutically, and the best recovery support practices we can. Mm-hmm. Which, if you listen to, you know, the SAMHSA, they talk about home, health, purpose, and community. So it's social drivers, it's life skills, it's you know, some of the work that Julie and her team does around harm reduction. There's, you know, there's pieces that fit all of that.
Yeah.
But taking a look at, you know, becoming a recovery-oriented organization and having it be part of our lexicon and what we think is in the best care model for a client, that's a big shift for a healthcare organization.
Yeah.
It's quite unheard of, you know, actually. So we have opportunities for expansion.
Yeah.
We know that this facility, for example, as a result of our model, we've been full.
Yeah.
The beds have been full for, you know, 5 years.
Yeah.
And we have a wait list of people that have qualified and been assessed for entry into the program of 30 to 70 people. So we know we need more.
Yeah.
So the expansion of our residential properties is one initiative. Also looking at how we integrate our recovery principles recovery capital measurement, into the service delivery across the agency. There's also an opportunity for us to bring thought leaders together. And we've talked about things like a Progress House Institute, where we can show people from other parts of the country or world, here's how you resource map the components, and here's the ways that you address some of the culture pieces. I think that it's probably lost on us sometimes that we're at the tip of the spear often. From an innovation standpoint. So there's no textbook for some of the things we're talking about.
That's right.
And this notion of recovery support and recovery capital really is, the last 20 years people have talked about, but really the last few years that it's getting to the point where, measurement tools and assessment tools and things like that are being developed.
Yeah.
And we've had EHRs forever, in our space. Yeah. So we're leaders in that regard. And I think what we're going to find is that as we go down this road and discover certain things about the way in which we're caring for this population, there's going to be things we haven't even discussed yet that we ought to be considering.
I think it's exciting.
Fact that we're open to that, Antony, is really quite remarkable for an organization. I'm proud to be here as well.
I am proud that you are here. I think it's really exciting. I would say this, that as we think about this service line, as we think about, in some ways, the maturation of a journey called recovery. At the same time, we won't lose the humanity and the passing of the torch from Gary to Darrell, and to Darrell from Darrell to many others whose lives will be better because of their connection with you and the community of Progress House, or Progress House. I'm going to get there finally, Darrell.
I say Progress House now too.
Good stuff. Good stuff. Darrell, thank you.
Thank you so much.
These opportunities to speak to my colleagues bring a little bit of emotion to me, because I think I am at my best when I'm revealing the story of other people, the truth of their brilliance, their commitment, and their energy. And Darrell embraces all of those things. Progress House has nothing to do with me. I had no part in the merger between Progress House and Aspire. But I'm sure glad there were people around like Darrell who made that commitment, because as an organization, we're better for it. There'll be more news on recovery in the coming months and years because of Darrell's leadership. But for now, thanks everybody. Take care, and we'll talk again soon.